King Nebuchadnezzar, who was a king during the Babylonian captivity, in Daniel chapter 4. So if you'd like to turn there, that's what we're going to be looking at today. You know, last week, the whole point of my lesson was that even if you don't feel useful, God's plan works through us. And that even bad people, whether they really intend to or not, end up working in God's plan one way or another. And one of the things we're going to be looking at with this story, with this particular king, is really how much a change of heart or a change of attitude can affect not only how impactful we are, but it can impact how much God is willing to do through us. In particular, Nebuchadnezzar is going to demonstrate some pride that he needs to overcome before God in order to have God exalt him and lift him up in what we're looking at today. And in this passage, we're going to be looking at not only Nebuchadnezzar's acts of pride, but his consequences for those things. But before we really get into the story, I'd like to present an idea to you. And it may be something that you're familiar with because I believe I've talked about it before. I have a personal theology of sin, which is to say that I believe that the Bible teaches us a particular thing about sin. But this is my personal philosophy and not necessarily from Scripture, so take this with whatever amount of salt you find appropriate. I think that if we're looking at any given sin, the root of that sin is pride. That anything that we might fail in, we might practice as inappropriate action, as a lifestyle that it goes against God, however you want to classify a sin, it all comes from pride. And pride is the hardest sin to shake, because a lot of times, pride in our position, in our lives, in our wealth, in our security, whatever those things may be that we might be proud of, kind of feels like we've earned it, right? We should be proud. After all, we've done so many great things, we're so safe and so wealthy and so strong, whatever those things we might have pride in may be. But the problem with that is it doesn't give credit where credit is due. That God is really responsible for giving us everything that we have. And so I would say, based on that, that pride is the basis for all sins. You think about the first sin that God Adam and Eve kicked out of the garden. The serpent appeals to Eve by saying, well, God just doesn't want you to be like him. But, you know, you're good enough. You know, you should be proud of how smart you are for thinking that this apple is for you, as we always illustrate it. You know, this fruit is, you know, you're worthy of it. And he really appeals to Eve's pride in getting her to eat from that fruit. And so when we see Nebuchadnezzar in his palace, looking out on all the things that he has done, and he boasts, he looks at all of the greedy wealth he's accumulated for himself, he's looking down upon his people as a superior and exhibiting haughtiness, all of these things really stem from his pride and that initial sin. And so the appropriate punishment for pride is total humiliation. We're going to see that in this passage here. The first thing that happens in Daniel chapter 4, however, I think is a little bit of a literary aside. I think that Nebuchadnezzar is giving us an introduction to this passage in these first few verses here. So this isn't necessarily what we're going to see as Nebuchadnezzar declaring how great God is and then immediately going against him. I think this is, on the other hand, Nebuchadnezzar saying, God is great. Now let me tell you why. So that's what we're going to be reading. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of all the peoples, nations, and men of every language that live in all the earth, may your peace abound. It has seemed good to me to declare the signs and wonders which the Most High God has done for me. How great are his signs and how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion is from generation to generation. I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at ease in my house and flourishing in my palace. I saw a dream, and it made me fearful. In these fantasies, as I lay on my bed, and the visions in my mind kept alarming me. So I gave orders to bring into my presence all the wise men of Babylon, that they may make known to me the interpretation of the dream. The magicians, the conjurers, the Chaldeans and the diviners came in, and I related the dream to them, but they could not make its interpretation known to me. But finally, Daniel came to me, whose name is Belteshazzar, according to the name of my God, and in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. I related the dream to him, saying, O Belteshazzar, chief of the magicians, since I know that a spirit of the holy gods is in you and no mystery baffles you, tell me the visions of my dream, which I have seen, along with its interpretation. So Daniel gets this task on hard mode, right? That the king says, all right, I told all the other guys what the dream was first, and then they interpreted it. He says, Daniel, you tell me what my dream was, and then you tell me what it means. And the reaction that he gets from Daniel is really kind of striking, and we'll see that in just a few verses here. But first, let's read what the dream was. Verse 10. Now, these were the visions in my mind as I lay on my bed. I was looking, and behold, there was a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height was great. The tree grew large and became strong, and its height reached to the sky. It was visible to the ends of the whole earth. Its foliage was beautiful, its fruit was abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it, and the birds of the sky dwelt in its branches, and all living creatures fed themselves from it. I was looking in the visions of my mind as I lay in my bed, and behold, an angelic watcher, a holy one, descended from heaven. He shouted out and spoke as follows: Chop down the tree, cut off its branches, strip off its foliage, and scatter its fruit. That the beasts and the birds from its branches, yet leave the stump with its roots in the ground, but with a band of iron and bronze around it, and the new grass in the field. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven, let him share with the beasts of the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from that of a man, let a beast's mind be given to him. Let 7 periods of time pass over him. This sentence is by the decree of angelic watchers, and this decision is a command of the holy ones. In order that the living may know that the Most High is ruler over the realm of mankind, and bestows it on whom he wishes, and sets over it the lowliest of men. This is the dream which I, Nebuchadnezzar, have seen. Now you, Belteshazzar, tell me its interpretation, as much as none of the wise men of my kingdom is able to make known to me the interpretation. But you are able, for the spirit of the holy gods is in you. Now, I'm not really sure here, because of the way he phrases this, that he's either writing this for our benefit as the audience, because it really seems to me, at the outset of this, he challenges Daniel to tell him the dream first, and it wouldn't be the first time that Daniel got a hard job to do. But, and then he goes on and lists the actual events of the dream. But in either case, whether Daniel had to provide it, or whether Nebuchadnezzar spoke it to him, Daniel is able to interpret the dream, and he is distressed by the images that are in the dream that he has to interpret for the king. Partially because the king is, if not a friend, a very close acquaintance of Daniel, spends a lot of time with him, he's in his court. And so now the king is going to be put through this terrible experience, and Daniel is, as we will see in verse 19, appalled at what the meaning of this dream was. Which you really can't blame him. Once we see what happens to Nebuchadnezzar, you wouldn't wish this on your worst enemy. It's kind of the craziest thing. Verse 19. Then Daniel, whose name is Belteshazzar, was appalled for a while as his thoughts alarmed him. The king responded and said, Belteshazzar, do not let the dream or its interpretation alarm you. Belteshazzar replied, My lord, if only the dream applied to those who hate you, and its interpretation to your adversaries. The tree that you saw, which became large and grew strong,
whose height reached to the sky and was visible to all the earth, and whose foliage was beautiful and its fruit abundant, and which was food for all, under which the beasts of the field dwelt, and in whose branches the birds of the sky lodged. It is you, O King, for you have become great and grown strong, and your majesty has become great and reached to the sky, and your dominion to the end of the earth. In that the king saw a watcher, a holy one, descending from heaven and saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, yet leave the stump with its roots in the ground, but with a band of iron and bronze around it, and the new grass of the field. And let him be drenched with the dew of heaven, and let him share with the beasts of the field until 7 periods of time pass over him. This is the interpretation of King, and this is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon the Lord my King, that you will be driven away from mankind in your dwelling place with the beasts of the field, and be given grass to eat like cattle, and be drenched with the dew of heaven. And 7 periods of time will pass over you, until you recognize that the Most High is ruler of the realm of mankind, and bestows it on whomever he wishes. And in that, it was commanded to live with the roots of the tree. Your kingdom will be assured to you after you recognize that it is heaven that rules. Therefore, O King, may my advice be pleasing to you. Break away now from your sins by doing righteousness, and from your iniquities by showing mercy to the poor, in case there may be a prolonging of your prosperity. So, the counsel of Daniel swift in regards to this prophecy, this curse that's been placed against the king Nebuchadnezzar. He says, if you will repent of these things you're doing, any wickedness that you have, do charity to everybody you can, you know, God will see these good things happening, and maybe he will change his mind. And what we can see is that Nebuchadnezzar doesn't necessarily follow Daniel's advice, because the result still comes about as the way the vision foretold. So, when looking at that in just a moment, let's just spend a little time reflecting on this. If you or I was in this situation, and you get this vision from God, and then God's messenger, who you know has like the power to interpret dreams and give you wisdom that you wouldn't be able to have, a supernatural insight into the way the world works, and he says, my advice, and I'm really concerned about you here, is that you repent, and here's a couple things that you could do that would probably help. I would probably go ahead and try and do those things. I would, you know, be as contrite as possible. I would demonstrate to this God who is able to give me a vision, and to his servant, Daniel, that I am willing to comply with whatever has been going on. But Nebuchadnezzar's pride apparently prevents that from happening. Because in verse 28 we see, all this happened to Nebuchadnezzar the king. 12 months later, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. The king reflected and said, is this not Babylon the Great, which I myself have built as a royal residence by the might of my power for the glory of my majesty? Nebuchadnezzar, seriously? I mean, can you get any more self-aggrandizing than that? I mean, you're standing on top of the palace, literally looking down on people, and declaring how great you are to have made all of this by your own power. I mean, he's inviting the problem at this point. Because at verse 31, while the word was in the king's mouth, he hadn't even finished saying his sentence. He hasn't even completed the thought of, look how great I am and all this good stuff I can do. And the voice comes to him. Now, a voice came from heaven saying, King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is declared, sovereignty has been removed from you. You will be driven away from mankind. Your dwelling place will be with the beasts of the field. You will be given grass to eat like cattle. And 7 periods of time will pass over you until you recognize that the Most High is ruler over the realm of mankind and bestows it on whomever he wishes. Immediately, the word concerning Nebuchadnezzar was fulfilled, and he was driven away from mankind and began eating grass like cattle. And his body was drenched with the dew of heaven until his hair had grown like eagle's feathers and his nails like bird's claws. At the end of that period, I, Nebuchadnezzar, raised my eyes towards heaven and my reason returned to me. And I bless the Most High, and praise and honor him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, but he does according to his will in the hosts of heaven. And among the inhabitants of the earth, and no one can ward off his hand or say to him, what have you done? At that time my reason returned to me, and my majesty and my splendor were restored to me for the glory of my kingdom. And my counselors and my nobles began seeking me out. So I was reestablished in my sovereignty, and surpassing greatness was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise, exalt, and honor the King of Heaven, for all his works are true and his ways just, and he is able to humble those who walk in pride. You know, it would be humiliating to act like a cow for 7 years. But it's only humbling when you acknowledge that God is the one who gives you those things and is able to take them away. Nebuchadnezzar was humiliated when he went and ate grass for 7 years. But he was humbled when he turned his face to God and asked him, acknowledged him, and praised him for what he had, what he was able to do. My favorite part of the way Nebuchadnezzar is talking about God and praises him in this little passage is that sort of last part of the poetic section there, because I don't think anybody else really uses this kind of language, and I like it. Because Nebuchadnezzar is basically saying, you know, when Nebuchadnezzar was a little boy, his mom and his teacher would say, don't do that, put that down, don't put that in your mouth, what are you doing, get over here, sit. Nebuchadnezzar had a boss at one point, right? But nobody's able to say to God, don't touch that, or look what you just did. What a powerful piece of language. Where Nebuchadnezzar knows that he's going to die, God's power lasts from age to age, generation to generation. Where Nebuchadnezzar has, you know, the biggest army in the world, a huge nation, a giant city that he can look down upon, God can account the inhabitants of the earth as nothing. There's nothing that can stand against the armies of heaven, as Nebuchadnezzar puts it there. But obfuscated in our religious language, host of heaven means army of heaven, right? The boundless army of people, the angels and whatever spiritual beings that God has on his side. Things that we can't even possibly begin to comprehend or calculate. So, you know, greed, boasting, blasphemy, all of these possible things that you could have ascribed to Nebuchadnezzar are all in his humiliation. But it's only really in his humble attitude and his recognition of God that God is willing to restore those things to him. We have a much better example and a better king in Jesus. He was willing to come as our king and live a very common life. He never, as far as we know, never owned a home, never had any property to speak of. He spent his time as an itinerant preacher, walking around and living off of the kindness of other people. And he did all of his work just to glorify God. He humbled himself in his everyday life. And at the moment where his enemy thought he'd been humiliated, he was actually the most glorified. At the moment when the spiritual enemy thought that they had made him into nothing and made a mockery of him, he actually became the most powerful thing that anything could ever be, the most powerful being, by being the God-man who died and then would later be resurrected. He transcended any sort of punishment that a human being could put on him. No person ever bring Jesus love, but instead he demonstrated what humility in the everyday life looks like so that we would never have to go through the punishments like this
King Nebuchadnezzar ever would on account of our pride. So if we're looking for a better king, it's not hard to find in Jesus. And we can continue to try and follow his example in our everyday lives. If you haven't followed his example in being baptized,